Thank you, Peter. Thank you for being here. Thank you for spending some time. It's, you know, I was reflecting because we've got all these founders, entrepreneurs who have built businesses and are building businesses. But most of them, there are some exceptions, but most of them didn't work in big institutional companies, you know, for a long time. And you were a leader, you know, for a long time in your industry, but in a big institution. And, you know, it's unusual to step out of that, you know, after such a long career, getting to the top of that and start something entrepreneurial. So, you know, after all that time doing that, what inspired you to kind of branch off on your own? Talk a little bit about what prompted that move.
You know, I think that a number of things. First of all, I had what I would consider the greatest job in the media business. You know, I think we were the most innovative, exciting, interesting company. You know, everybody's working for somebody, whether it's a board or boss. And Rupert was, in my mind, the best boss anybody could have. He was remarkably both generous and fun and crazy and everything you want in a boss. You know, we in many ways had acted as a startup company in all those years. You know, I think if you look at what Disney and Comcast just bought, almost all of those things we started from scratch. You know, when I joined the company, it had the fifth place movie studio, probably the sixth place television studio.
When did you join?
I joined in 1989 to go run the network, which was a year and a half old at that point. And everything of value there, we built from scratch. We built the broadcast network from scratch. We built Fox News from scratch, Fox Sports from scratch. We built Sky from scratch, Star from scratch, the largest group of international cable channels. And so I had a phenomenal job building things. And, you know, when it came time to sign another five-year contract, I began to feel, I believe correctly in hindsight, that the media business was about to enter into a wildly different phase. It was about to go from being a rapid growth business to a business that started playing defense, that started trying to protect most of their existing assets. And to be blunt, I didn't want to do that. You know, the things I had enjoyed, I didn't really care about the perch. You know, and I was hopefully smart enough to realize that the perch wasn't me, the perch was the perch. And but I knew that what had given me joy and satisfaction was starting things, was starting and building things from scratch. And it felt like the company and the industry was about to enter a period where they were doing less of that. I also believe that because of that, there were real opportunities for startups like us to compete against them. You know, and I would immodestly like to believe that, you know, what we built in Otter Media, you know, in the last basically a little over 3 years, you know, we got it to just under 2.2 million subscribers, $500 million in revenue, is a better digital media company than any of the other media companies have built in that time.
Right.
Because we weren't trying to, we were happy to disintermediate and disrupt their businesses, which they were uptight about. And, you know, we didn't have margins or expectations that we needed, but we were happy to invest in it.
That benefit of a white sheet of paper and really being able to structure it the way you want to structure it. You are the creator and the architect of Hulu. And, you know, that obviously is an entrepreneurial thing, you know, in a broader context. Walk us through in the process of creating that. You know, what surprised you about that whole process? And then everything you learned and where it sits today, how does that inform us about where we are today and the way the world's going to continue to evolve?
Well, first of all, I would say Hulu is a remarkable lesson on disruption inside big companies. Mm-hmm. And for the most part, a negative lesson, a real lesson about what big companies do badly. So we conceived of Hulu before Netflix had launched online. So nobody had done this yet. We came up with the idea. And my thought process was, wasn't overwhelmingly grandiose. It was sort of two things, which is one, I was very concerned about piracy. And I believe that where piracy thrives is where goods and services aren't readily available to people at an appropriate price. And people couldn't get movies online where they desperately wanted them. They had to wait a long time to get them. And so you could see piracy increasing. And so one thing is I just wanted to figure out a way to make our stuff available online. The second thing is I kept looking at HBO, and I kept saying, HBO was a multi-billion dollar business built on the back of three or four studios, just licensing. And I said, I believed that there was going to be a transition to movies online, to movies and television shows being streamed, and I said, we should own it this time. We shouldn't let somebody else do it and just take licensing revenue. And so we started, and I started originally just with Jeff Zucker at NBC,
right,
who was a phenomenal partner, was a remarkably great partner. And every single person in the company hated it. You know, the head of the network would come to me and say, you're killing me, you can't make this. And the head of syndication would say, you're going to ruin my syndication value. You're going to, head of ad sales, the head of the game. And I basically would say, you know what, shut up and go back in your office and just go do your job. And your job isn't to protect your business, because if your business is going to be disrupted, it's going to be disrupted by somebody. Your job is to maximize your business. And the company's job is to build new businesses faster than the old ones decay.
Right.
And so we launched this thing. Jeff and I left at about the same time. And basically, the day I left, both companies set out to start throttling it. They started increasing the ad load. They started delaying the release date. And look, at the time it was launched, Hulu had probably 20x better content than Netflix did. It had all that content. And if they hadn't deliberately slowed it down because they were worried about what it was going to do to the business, those companies would own $175 billion in market cap and not Netflix. And it's a really good example of what big companies can do wrong trying to protect things, because you can't protect things.
Right.
Right. Somebody's going to disrupt it, and you're better off doing it yourself.
To that point, then, can media companies thrive today without a direct-to-consumer model?
Or over time as we go forward?
My gut is, and probably thrive in the short term, but really short term, like 5-7 years, and then they'll get crushed. But I think that there's a short window right now where you have 4 or 5 big competitors throwing billions of dollars at the direct competitor.
Tens of billions.
Right, you know, Netflix, Amazon, Time Warner's gonna do it with HBO, Disney's gonna do it with their thing, Apple's spending $2 billion, Walmart's talking about launching, and so I actually think none of them are gonna have enough quality content for a period of time, and probably not a bad time to be an arms dealer and just sell to them, but that'll only last until they really get their act together, and then they're gonna crush you. So,
and it's just, in the context of that, the distribution's a commodity, it's purely the bulk of content, the breadth of content, the power of that, because it brings convenience if you're on that platform, if it's got the scope.
Yeah, I think if you look at those platforms, they are, if you look at sort of consumer behavior on those platforms, they are really a function of two different things. One is profile, so consumers want to know, where's Game of Thrones? Where is Stranger Things? Where there are a few things that are really high profile, and they'll go for those things. But then they also want real bulk. They want to be able to say, I can go there anytime watch something that I can, find something that I watch, and I'm getting enough utility. And the hard part is to balance those two things, is to both be able to get enough high profile things, but also get enough bulk. And you can see both. It'll be interesting to watch both. Probably the two best examples are Netflix, which is struggling to get the really high, get enough really high profile things, has phenomenal volume.
Yeah.
And HBO coming out from the other side. HBO has phenomenal high profile things.
But not enough breadth.
But not enough breadth. And you're gonna see them both try and figure out what their version of that is.
Can you know, like anything else, supply and demand matters, you know, in the world. Tens of billions of dollars being spent. How quickly do we make too much content that the returns on the content don't work?
Well, you know, the big challenge right now is that, and it's a huge challenge for the traditional media companies, is none of those direct-to-consumer streaming platforms are fundamentally economic right now.
Right.
So if you're a media company valued on some multiple of earnings and looking to get into that, it's a scary thing because you have, let's just go through it. You know, Netflix never made a penny. You know, and hugely successful, but losing $1.5 billion a year. One of the most remarkable statistics in the media business, which doesn't get talked about, Netflix has somewhere in the, I don't know what it is today, but let's call it $25 billion in corporate debt, and has never made an acquisition. Yeah. So it's just $25 billion of cumulative operating losses. So On one hand, you got to compete with somebody who's willing to lose that kind
with of money. With $150 billion market cap.
Right. Yeah. Higher than that.
Higher than that point, now, probably.
Up to about 180, 190. And valued only on growth and playing. Look, and I have infinite respect for Reed and what he's doing, but playing for that growth thing, not playing for profitability.
Yeah, for the growth.
You have Amazon spending $7, $8 billion saying, I don't care what happens here. What I know is that people who watch things on Prime buy more stuff. And I'll make my money on them buying more stuff. So I don't really care if I make money on Prime. So trying to compete against that.
Even though they don't yet make money on people buying stuff. Yeah.
But again, they're playing that long
game. They will one day maybe, but not yet.
Right. And they're playing that long game, which is we want to own everybody's buying online.
Yeah.
It also seems like a pretty good bet.
Yeah.
Apple spending $2 billion right now for I'm not even sure what reasons. Spending a couple hundred million dollars with me, so I'm happy about it. But again, probably having something to do with the stickiness of device and device retention. So if you're sitting there trying, and AT&T interestingly positioned, because in the long run, AT&T's economics are so much more significant on subscriber acquisition costs and retention costs on the mobile business, that if they can use content to help those metrics on their mobile business, they don't really care whether they make money on that either.
Mm-hmm.
And then it'll be interesting to see how Disney, which is a profitable company valued on profitability, how they compete.
Is there anything in particular as you look forward that you think is becoming increasingly important to compete for engagement and attention of consumers?
I think there is one huge issue which in my mind, and you know, I'm a big believer in try to think about where consumers are being underserved, which I think if I were an entrepreneur, I assume that's the only thing any of you are thinking about, because it's truly the only thing that matters, is I think there's one huge choke point in the whole thing right now, which is curation recommendation. I think there is so much stuff out there, and I think consumers are wildly underserved in their ability. It's not money that's the scarce commodity in that sense, because these things are all Netflix is a great bargain. It's time. It's how do you figure out what is worth my 2 hours tonight? And it's not solved at all. I don't believe, you know, I'd be curious how many people here have ever watched something that Netflix has recommended to them algorithmically. I don't think it happens that often. And it's so vast that, you know, I certainly know myself. It's a hard experience to go through Netflix and figure out what to watch.
Figure out what you want to watch.
Figure out what you want to watch next. And you end up doing some weird, it's mostly word of mouth, or your friends have told you, or somebody's recommend, but there's got to be a better way to give consumers information and curation to figure out what they want to watch at any given time. And I think it's a big choke point in the entire industry.
And based on the amount of content that's being made, the money spent, it's only going to grow. It's only going to become a bigger issue.
Well, now, because you now have the issue of you'll wake up and say, I want to watch something. And the first thing you got to figure out, if it's something that exists, go, is that on Hulu? Is that on Netflix? Is that on Amazon? Is it on pay-per-view? Do I got to go to iTunes and buy it? You know, where is it? And you got to spend 15 minutes trying to find, and I'm not that smart, so I always do it by trial and error. I go to Netflix first, then I go to Amazon, and then I go. And it's a bad process.
Yeah. You know, Facebook and Google at this point are siphoning off the vast majority of digital ad dollars. How realistic is it today to build an advertising-driven digital business from scratch?
Right now, it is pretty easy to start ad-based businesses, but they better be really targeted and small, because you're going to run into those guys at
very quickly.
I think it is not only easy but highly meaningful to start, particularly in things that are media related, to start multi-revenue businesses of which advertising is a piece. So, you know, we now own one, don't own the other, but two great examples of that. We own Rooster Teeth, which was a business inside Otter, and we own Barstool Sports. Both those businesses are pretty similar, which is we generally do about a quarter of our revenue from advertising, we do about a quarter from live events, we do a quarter about from licensing and merch, we do a chunk from podcasting, we do a chunk from subscription. Advertising as a piece of that is actually pretty effective because it's both an effective revenue stream, but it's also a great source of customers for those other things. It's a great way to get people because it's by definition broader because there's no paywall to get beyond.
Right.
So it's a great way to get people to buy merchandise or sign up for subscription services. So I think it's a big piece of that. I do believe that it's only a matter of time before Google and Facebook get disrupted. If I knew how, I'd
You'd be
much
spending
more
time on it. Yeah.
But they'll get disrupted at some point.
Yeah, everything runs a cycle. How should you think about, you know, brand identity with growth in digital? You know, how much money has to be spent on that? And, you know, how has it changed vis-a-vis where you are if you look back 10, 20 years with the studios?
Branding is certainly enormously important. I think that the question, the really interesting challenge from a consumer perspective, from a digital perspective right now, is the balance between customer acquisition marketing dollars and brand marketing dollars. And in general, I think most certainly nascent digital brands are better off spending most of their money on customer acquisition marketing.
Right.
Because you got to get the customers.
Right.
You got to figure out a way to target them, and at least there's an immediate return. And, you know, at this point, there's enough virality in most of these things that most of the brand identity is coming from app store rankings, word of mouth, you know, those kinds of things. So the brand is hugely important, but I'm not sure I'd be marketing.
Right.
You know, I don't think the days of AOL, where they were spending billions of dollars of brand marketing, are necessarily relevant anymore.
Right. So, you know, as we talked before, you spent a bunch of time in a large organization. You've also created a much smaller organization. Talk about culture and organizations, and from being in a big organization for a long time, then doing something, you know, more entrepreneurial. What are the cultural similarities, and what do you think some of the differences are that matter, you know, culturally when you're starting something on your own, you're building your own platform?
Look, I guess I'd say probably the biggest difference is most large organizations have an enormous amount of existing cultural DNA. And, you know, you can improve it and you can adjust it, but Goldman Sachs is Goldman Sachs.
They have an identity.
Right? Yeah.
It's grown over a long period of time. It's not always the same. It develops over time.
And your job is to evolve it in the right direction. Your job not necessarily to do a U-turn, because generally won't be successful. And I guess the biggest difference is you are establishing culture from day one in any sort of entrepreneurial startup thing. How you deal with those things from day one, how much you listen to people, what opportunities you give people for advancement, what opportunities you give people to really feel that they're part of making things, cross-collaboration opportunities, those get established in the early weeks, months, year of a company. And I think there's a much bigger spotlight on them than there is in an existing company.
Yeah, it's a good way to frame it. When you're looking to hire somebody for something entrepreneurial, there's certainly a whole bunch of skills that you're looking for, you know, to the positive, but is there something you look to avoid when you're looking to hire an entrepreneur to build something for you?
Jerks.
Besides that, obvious.
No, I guess what I'd say is, but I want to put a finer point on it. The point I mean is, look, I think the thing that's important for entrepreneurs is a relentless, obsessive focus on your customer, whether that customer is individuals, whether that customer is other businesses, but really being obsessive about, look, almost every great entrepreneur I know started with some sort of notion of there's a gap here, or there's a piece of friction, or there's something that's being underserved. And you want entrepreneurs who are relentlessly focused on that every moment of every day, because by definition, you're going to have lots of problems, and you're only going to solve those problems by going back to thinking about customers. And arrogance tends to make you think you know all the answers and tends to pull you away from that focus.
Appreciate it. Thank you, Peter. And thank you for being here. Really appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Thanks. That was great. Appreciate it.